We're back to a base camp, and the rescue took about 6 hours. Officials say rescues at this altitude are nearly impossible.
Only 14 mountains around the world are taller than 8,000 meters. When you cross that height, you enter the death zone, which is a place where there isn't enough oxygen for people to live. This is where fatigue also sets in, impeding one's cognitive sharpness. Many people who try to defeat K2 have died because of its cruel nature. Every step is a fight against the weather, but the peak is still a place of wild beauty. This is why K2 is called the Savage Mountain, and why it is a death sentence to climb it. But why does it continue to get riskier each year? Let's find out in this video. So K2's increasing danger each year can be attributed, in part, to the growing numbers of climbers. The popularity surge sounds positive, but it creates bottlenecks on treacherous routes. These congestions prolong exposure to harsh conditions and heighten risk of frostbite, exhaustion, and altitude sickness. The situation becomes progressively difficult with unpredictable weather, steep technical climbs, and remote locations. Inadequate experience of the climbers combined with an extraordinary drive to conquer the peak also contributes to the difficulty. While more adventurers aim to conquer the challenge, the mountain's unforgiving nature remains constant, demanding respect and preparation to mitigate the mounting dangers. Interestingly, K2 started becoming known as the Savage Mountain because George Bell, a climber on the 1953 American expedition, told reporters, "It's a savage mountain that tries to kill you," and he wasn't wrong. Until recently, about 20 people died every year. But on average, one person died for every four successful climbs. In 2022, three more people died because of K2. Also, it used to be true that more people have been to space than have stood at the top of K2. We'll explain what we mean by "until recently" later in this video. So why is K2 so dangerous? To really understand how dangerous this mountain is, it helps to break it down into four parts: where it is, how high it is, and what the weather's like, and how hard it is to climb. So let's start with where it is. The best way to show how far away it is to look at how it got its name. In 1856, when the British were trying to figure out where the line between Kashmir and China was, they did the first survey of the area. The mapper would write down a mountain height and call it K1. He or she would then name another mountain XK2, and so on. Then they asked the locals, "What's the mountain called?" That's how they got the names like Gash Habram and Kanjutsar. The name K2 was given to the mountain by British surveyors in the early 20th century. The mountain was originally referred to as Peak K, with K standing for Karakoram, the range in which the mountain is located. The Peak K name was later deemed confusing and lacked local significance, so it was changed to K2 to avoid confusion with other regional peaks. It takes about a week just to get to the base camp before you can start to climb. So you have to cross a tricky glacier and a rocky path that could easily hurt you before you even start climbing the mountain. Due to the harshness of the environment, most of the climber's time is confined to tents. Comparing this to Mount Everest, where getting to base camp is much easier and there are warm tea houses along the way. Because K2 is so far away and high up, it is much harder to get a search and rescue chopper there. This, along with the fact that only the Pakistan Army is allowed to fly in the area because it's so close to India's war zone, making it much more likely that any injuries will be deadly. Not to forget that K2 is the second highest peak in the world, situated in the Karakoram mountain range. It gets as high as 8,611 meters. On the final climb, you enter the death zone, a place where your body uses air faster than it can replace it. This is what makes the mountain so dangerous. You will eventually die if you stay in the death zone for a long time without extra air. Your body tries to adjust by making more red blood cells, making your heart beat faster, and shutting down processes that aren't necessary. One also takes deeper breaths, but getting used to a new place isn't a quick process. It can take weeks. This is why some people get altitude sickness, such as high altitude lung edema or high altitude cerebral edema. Many people died in the death zone because they had less brain power and strength. Even though weather prediction has come a long way since K2 was first climbed in 1954, hikers know the weather is still hard to predict. It is farther north than Everest, making it more likely that the jet stream will bring bad weather. In case you're wondering, the jet stream is a fast-moving river of air in the Earth's atmosphere that can cause the weather to change quickly. In the winter, K2 can get winds that are as strong as hurricanes, which will blow hikers off the mountain like they were nothing. On top of that, there's a higher chance of avalanches, and the K2 accident of 2008 shows you how bad they can be. Some details about what happened on August 1st and 2nd, 2008, when 11 people died and 3 were seriously hurt, are still unknown. But we do know that an avalanche occurred in a place called the Bottleneck on the Rise. The storm broke a lot of hikers' ropes, which is a sad way to say that they died. So when you start to climb K2, you're already fighting a lost battle because of where it is, how high it is, and the weather. But the climb itself makes the problem almost impossible to solve. The Abruzzi Spur, which we're about to talk about, is the most popular road on K2. More than 75% of hikers go this way. The western, south, and east face are even more difficult to climb, and the east face has never been done. Knowing that this is the easy way makes it clear how dangerous the mountain is. Once you reach base camp, you're about 5,000 meters above sea level. The entire ascent from base camp to Camp 3, situated at 7,350 meters, features a challenging incline range between 60 and 70 degrees, exerting considerable strain on climbers. Progressing from there, the initial segment is referred to as the house chimney. The section entails a 100-foot-long crevice within a chimney-shaped rock formation, posing difficulties for climbers equipped with crampons. As for the subsequent checkpoint beyond the base camp, Camp 2 is roughly 6,760 meters above sea level. And then, en route to Camp 3, the path entails climbing the Black Pyramid, an extensive formation of steep rock that extends from the primary ridge. This is one of the toughest parts of the climb. When you get close to Camp 3, you must climb a 25-foot-tall steep wall of ice, but finally, you get to Camp 3. From this juncture, a mere 1,350 meters separate you from the end of the climb. Regrettably, the journey is far from straightforward. Camp 3 is situated upon a 30-degree incline, impeding a restful night's sleep. Upon reaching Camp 4, characterized by a relatively level terrain, a sense of relief may set in. However, with this elevation perched at 8,000 meters, this marks the entry into the dangerous death zone, amplifying the imperative of oxygen management. Camp 4 assumes the role of an interlude before the impending challenge. While restoration is possible, the realization remains that the most demanding phase of the ascent lies ahead, named the Bottleneck. As you walk through the narrow gully with the steep slope, this is what you see. An overhead sirocco, or block of glacial ice, that weighs millions of tons and has fallen before, like in the 2008 disaster we talked about earlier. Images can help us see how big it is, and a video of a sirocco breaking off on another mountain shows how unpredictable things can be. When the sirocco on K2 breaks, it's not just a small piece of ice that comes rushing towards you. It's a huge mass that's getting faster and faster. Now imagine these circumstances when you are tired, weak, and 8,000 meters above sea level. But you've already done it. You've made it to the top. Your hard work, tears, and sweat have paid off. But the thing is, things could get worse from here on out. You must now descend. And think of the whole trip as a tank of energy. Every time you work hard, you lose a little bit of power. But you want to finish your goal and reach the peak so badly that you push your body to its limits. You might not even think to save half of your strength for the way down. Because of this, more than 80% of deaths are thought to happen on the way down. You're weaker, more tired, and less smart. You may also have a little less drive. These are some of the most crucial factors that make K2 extremely dangerous. As technology improves and social media continues to attract more mountaineering aspirants to K2, it also increases the likelihood of bottlenecks at some of the toughest areas on the mountain. For similar content, feel free to have a look at some of the clips on your screen. Until then, goodbye.